Right, enhanced further by the high probability of being elevated to investment grade in 2013 by top credit rating agencies. With this encouraging economic environment, the Philippines is set to stage an investment summit early next year, a landmark event expected to draw serious investors and capital market participants looking into expanding their investment portfolios in the Philippines. Now, here to tell us about the summit and to give us a look at market prospects for 2013 is Mr. Jojo Dispo. He's the president of First Metro Investment Corporation. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Ron.
First, I want to ask you what the Philippine Investment Summit is all about. You've had it this year, but what's going to be different next year for 2013?
Well, this is an annual thing that First Metro holds. We did it first time last September. We brought in like something like 70 global funds who became interested to invest in our capital market. This time, the difference is that we will be bringing in Dr. Rubini, the famous economist based in New York University. And his claim to fame is he was able to predict the property bust in U.S. and also the 08-09 global crisis. So in terms of stature, track record, is well respected in the industry, so
and,
to speak.
And for this summit, he's going to tell us or those participants, the participants of your event, on what would be the prospects for next year and the coming year, especially for the Philippines.
That's right, Ron. We want to tell the good news to our global audience, and it will be self-serving if we will do it ourselves. So Rubini is in the best position to do that because he believes in the growth story of the Philippines, and he will be telling the audience, though, global fund managers and foreign investors, that indeed Philippines may be ripe or ready for a credit upgrade. Anchored on robust capital markets, record-setting equity markets, very strong economic fundamentals, and robust domestic market that supports our economic growth. So many of these stories now will be relayed no less than by Dr. Rubini.
Of course, it's going to be nice for someone outside to tell everybody, hey, this is what how I view what's happening here in the Philippines, in case you still don't believe your officials here. But it has been doing good here in the Philippines. The economy is looking up, and of course, we're waiting for that that high probability of an investment upgrade by next year. But tell us the factors. First, we were talking about Indonesia a while ago, why Dr. Rubini was saying that Indonesia was going to be improving its economy, how its economy is improving. But here in the country, what have been the factors in the improvement of the economy?
By the way, Ron, it was Rubini who predicted that Indonesia will be upgraded to credit investment grade way back in September last year, and that they were upgraded in November. Zeroing in our country, it is really the economic fundamentals that lifting the economy at large. You have a very fairly strong exchange rate, low interest rate environment. There's adequate liquidity in the system, both coming from domestic investors and also foreign investors. There's also a reason why our equity market is reaching a record high. And then infrastructure program is beginning to kick in. That will translate to a lot of projects being completed in the country. And again, it's a main attraction for foreign investment to come in. Our debt as a percentage of GDP is coming up. I think now it stands at 50% of GDP. Next year, many economies are predicting that it will go as low as 45%, which is one of the main conditions why rating agencies are still waiting for that figure to come up to 40% of GDP before they can actually accord us the investment grade rating.
And now is a perfect time to invest in the country.
It's a perfect time.
Best time? Is it the best time?
I think there's more to come. We are in a sweet spot.
Wow.
The term that we're using is we are in a sweet spot. And this is something that is sustainable as far as bankers, finance people, and economies are concerned. Because, well, the OFW remittances has always been there, supporting our economy. But there's another growth sector that's helping us move forward quite aggressively, and that is the BPO call center. You know, this year they will bring in $15 billion in revenues. By 2016, the estimated revenues coming from BPO call center will reach $25 billion. So you now have a twin engine of growth supporting our economy, the OFW remittances, and then the BPO call center. So we see this as something that is irreversible. Mm-hmm. Because elsewhere in the developed countries, they're encountering what we call as demographic winter. People are aging. Mm-hmm. So they will continue to need young, talented labor force coming from
Philippines. And we have that.
Mm-hmm. And other ASEAN countries. Mm-hmm. And then BPO, again, anchored on the special set of skills of Filipinos, so multilingual, lingual, very skilled in terms of dealing with clients. So these are all our main attraction as we speak.
But you mentioned two factors, the BPO industry and OFW remittances, but there is also that factor of a stronger peso, which you mentioned a while ago. Is it going to have that much of an effect on that? Because we're getting money from other countries.
And very good
point. If we're talking about the dollar, then it has a diminishing power right now.
Very good point, Ron. The strong peso means lesser pesos for OFW remittances. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then for BPO call centers, because they're earning US dollars, that means, again, lesser peso when translated their profit from dollar to peso. But, you know, Filipinos, particularly in the BPO call centers, are very enterprising. You know, they're moving out of the metropolis and going to as far as Zamboanga, Cagayan de Oro, Bohol. No? I was just in Davao. No? There's a lot of call center operations in Davao. They have lower electricity, lower labor costs. Mm. So that, in a way, offset the strength of the Philippine peso. On the side of OFWs, because their remittances translate to lower peso,
yes,
and they may probably complain that they can buy less, you'll be surprised. The reason why the inflation rate for October dipped to 2.6 from 3.2 the previous month is that we have lower cost of food, lower cost of fuel and transport. So meaning to say that since our country imports much of our food and we are a net importer of oil, strong peso means that these foreign goods are becoming cheaper. So it translates to lower consumption cost for consumers. So it somehow offsets. It offsets. And we're seeing it. This is not anecdotal. We've seen it in the inflation number. The one that really drove inflation lower in the recent month was really low cost of food, oil, transport, and utilities, including electricity.
And we just have to cross our fingers that that remains so.
Well, BSP, I think, is very vigilant. No? They want to maintain an optimal balance between the peso and the dollar so that it may not appreciate very strong, because that may cause some structural problem down the road. So I think they're maintaining it at a range of 40, 42. To a dollar.
Okay, but going back to the event, who would benefit from attending the event? Who should be joining in?
Well, the investment summit is open to foreign delegates. We're expecting around 300, 400 foreign delegates to come in. They are the OGEDs, no, for this particular summit. We will be basically showcasing to them, no, via Rubini discourse, the achievements of the country as far as macroeconomic fundamentals are concerned, the strength of the financial system. By the way, the ASEAN banking system has been officially declared as the strongest banking systems in the entire world. No? Mm-hmm. Because we learned our lessons way back in 1997, many ASEAN banks right now have capitalized and fully strengthened their balance sheets. Mm-hmm. So compared to European banks, American banks, ASEAN banks are the strongest as we speak. So again, that would also be highlighted in the summit. And then the very favorable economic situation, no, that is very favorable for foreign investments to come in. And then strong domestic market. Our population is nearing 100 million. That's a strong consumer support. If you add that with additional consumer market in the entire ASEAN, you're looking at like a billion in terms of population, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore. So basically, we're going to highlight Philippines and also ASEAN as a region, as a center of gravity of all the economic activities
and
in
I believe,
the world.
Yeah, in the coming years, there is going to be that that trade agreement with ASEAN that's going to be fully implemented. That's right.
Yeah, that's that's very nice, no, Ron. It will create economic bridges, no, among the ASEAN countries. It will pave the way for free trade, and then it will also lead to integration of capital markets. So a Filipino company can now issue bonds in Malaysia,
that's
Singapore,
right, that's right.
And then vice versa via cross-border transactions. So integration will happen not just in the bond market, but also in the equity market, meaning Filipinas companies can also list in Singapore.
That's
in the same
right,
manner Singaporean
yes.
companies can list here. So we're just looking at the recent statistics. ASEAN plus other emerging markets, Indonesia, China and India, mm-hmm. now accounts for 52% of the world's GDP. So that's how important nowadays. No? The ASEAN economies combined on a combined basis, mm-hmm. plus India and China. So we're a force to reckon with. And Philippines is strategically located in the ASEAN region. So again, main selling point that we are part of that growth area. So global fund managers can put in their money here, and they're expected to make a good returns on their investments.
And the Philippine Investment Summit 2013 will be tackling those issues and a lot more, of course, Dr. Rubini being the keynote speaker that event. That's going to be on the 30th of January at the Shangri-La in Manila.
Manila.
Mr. Jojo Dispo, the president of First Metro Investment Corporation, thank you very much, sir, for talking to us this morning. Let's go back to Warren now for stock market update.